and the deans and directors are expected to arrive at 3:45 a.m. So we will try to cover this within this 40-45 minutes, sir. Sir, welcome again, sir, and Dr. J.P. Vasani, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Pallav. Now, today I will be talking about the canine cardiomyopathy. Actually, what is actual canine cardiomyopathy? If you look, canine cardiomyopathy is a disease of cardiac muscle, where only the muscle is involved. On you'll see the incidence, why it is important. This is the second most important cardiac disease in canines, responsible for high mortality. If cardiomyopathy is not attended to, it may be a fatal. The estimates of its incidence throughout the world has been carried out, and mostly they are based on hospital studies or student studies. So overall, when you see the cardiac diseases in a hospital population, this range to 10 to 26% diseases of heart in the dogs. And in UK, every year, 2 million dogs of heart disease are added in a clinic. So such a high incidence. In USA, the estimate says that 10 to 12% patients are of a cardiomyopathy. Studies have been done in India also, but they are also limited with a 1 or 2 years, only on a hospital basis. And they vary in the study manner. Some has worked out how many total incidents of the total dogs came in the clinic and how many were of a heart disease. Such type of estimate were taken in a Madras, and they found that hardly there is a 0.3% diseases of heart in dogs. So it has diluted. So for all purposes, dogs are coming and we are taking the only heart patient. Other type of studies is where there is a cardiopulmonary disturbance, where dyspnea is there. Such type of studies were taken in Andhra, where they have studied about 826 dogs. When then they found that out of 826 dogs, there was 26.14% dogs, they had a cardiac disease. In amongst cardiac diseases, the dilated cardiomyopathy was responsible for 52.3% DCM cases. So dilated cardiomyopathy, if you see the population, whole population of 826, then the incidence comes about 13.76%. So the you cannot compare one survey with other because there are no standard practice have been made, but they say definitely that there is a very, very high incidence of cardiac diseases in canine, and out of which the cardiomyopathy is fearing a large share. When by age group you go, take a geriatric patient, you will find 80% or 70% incidence of heart disease. And out of which more than 70-80% is a dilated cardiomyopathy. And that also differs from the breed. These all surveys, they do not specify what breed they have specified. Because when we say dilated cardiomyopathy, it is the larger breed. So if the dog population of larger breed in some surveys more, incidence will be more. If less, then incidence will be less. So there are many lacunas in these surveys, but in nutshell, there is a very high incidence. In cardiac disease, there are three types of cardiac disease. One is myocardium, other is valve, and third is vessel. So vessel and valve, they have a separate identity, and today we are discussing with it myocardium. Now, then actually, what is cardiomyopathy? Actually, cardiomyopathy was diagnosed and characterized in 1970 by the Ettinger group. Ettinger group first established that cardiomyopathy occurs in a canine, and this study was carried out in 1970. At that time, they define it is a primary heart disease associated with a mechanical dysfunction of the heart where the heart systole is affected, and which is leading to secondary filling defect in the ventricle. There is ventricle dilation. Then later studies said that their wall thickness may be reduced or may not be reduced. But today's scenario is that that definition is not taking care of the electrical disturbances which do take place in the case of primary myocardial disease also. So by revising the definition today, this is cardiomyopathy is a primary myocardial disease associated with a mechanical and electrical disturbance. And mechanical disturbances are systolic by and large, but to some cases diastolic also, like in a hypertrophic cardiomyopathy or restrictive myocardiopathy, where it is a diastolic dysfunction is there. So these systolic and dysfunctions lead to secondarily ventricular dilation, and wall thickness in dilated cardiomyopathy remains almost same or reduced. It does not increase. And there is a increased volume, cardiac volume. So these, and arrhythmias are there, and arrhythmias and increased cardiac volume, they are responsible for the death. So in this way, technically, we can define the cardiomyopathy. Now, what are the various type of cardiomyopathy? If you look, there are two type of cardiomyopathy. One is primary and other is secondary. In cases of primary, the etiology remains obscure. So it has been postulated that most of the primary cardiomyopathies are of a genetic inheritance, or they are of genetic nature, or they are inherited. And the primary or idiopathic cardiomyopathy is again of a three type. One is dilated, other is hypertrophic, and third is restrictive. And dilated was established systolic failure in 1970, as I said earlier. And hypertrophic cardiomyopathy is rare in dog, but it does occur. But it is more common in cats. In this rare hypertrophic, there is a concentric hypertrophy of the left ventricle, and it is associated with a diastolic failure rather than systolic. And restrictive cardiomyopathy is seen only in cat. There is a fibrous infiltration of the wall of the ventricle and the endocardium. Again, it is a diastolic dysfunction, not a systolic dysfunction. Now, you see, these are the pictorial pictures to show you how the changes occur in a dilated and hypertrophic. This is a normal heart. This is the normal wall of the ventricle. This is normal chamber size of the left ventricle. When it becomes dilated, you see the chamber size increase. The volume of the chamber is increased so that there can be a more blood filling, and there can be a more diastolic pressure, diastolic pressure. And in the wall becomes thin. And while in hypertrophic, the ventricular wall becomes thick, and the available volume in the ventricle which can receive the blood is reduced. So there is a basic difference in hypertrophic and dilated. In dilated, muscles are almost thin or same, or in hypertrophic, cardiac muscles are very thick, ventricular muscles are very thick, septa is very thick, decreasing the available volume where the blood can come of the ventricle. Now, secondary cardiomyopathy, actually most of these studies, they have been restricted to the primary cardiomyopathy. So there is the incidence, they have difference in incidence. What we expect today, the incidence of cardiomyopathy will be much higher than the old studies, because in these studies, they have not taken care of the secondary cardiomyopathy, which occur in very many diseases. Secondary cardiomyopathy can occur in the cardiac diseases not related to wall thickness, like ischemia, it is MIMI, microscopic intramural infarction. This is a rare condition, but do occur in the dog. It is different from human infarction, ischemic heart disease. Then in arterial hypertension, arterial hypertension is seen in dogs due to kidney failure, chronic kidney failure. There you can get. Then dilatation and volvulus in endocarditis cases or in infectious diseases like viral and myocarditis, bacterial myocarditis or endocarditis, or protozoal diseases like Babesia, Ehrlichial diseases like Ehrlichia, hepatozoon canis. There can be the secondary cardiomyopathy. In the non-cardiomyopathy region, they are physical causes, hypothermia, trauma, falls, CNS disturbances, or serious CNS trauma. In all conditions, there can be cardiomyopathy. Second, then metabolic diseases like diabetes, hypo and hyperthyroidism, uremia, electrolyte imbalances, and hyperadrenocorticism, they can also lead to cardiac disturbances. Then nutritional disturbances, they are responsible for primary cardiomyopathy in dogs like taurine, carnitine. But they are more common. They are deficiency in boxers and Doberman. And vitamin E deficiency also lead to cardiac dysfunctioning. Vitamin A and anemia, hypotension also. And then when we do the cancer therapy with doxorubicin, this toxicity can also lead to cardiomyopathy. Then some immunological diseases like lupus erythematosus and very many other diseases can also cause cardiomyopathy. So there is a scope that we can evaluate almost all diseases, see whether what is the percentage of cardiomyopathy in other diseases. Now, what is the etiology of cardiomyopathy? Though in primary, they say etiology is obscure, it is of a genetic origin, a genetic predisposition. But other causes, as we enumerated earlier, there's a physical cause, chronic volume overload, myocarditis, maybe endocarditis, it may be infectious, or systemic diseases, very systemic diseases, we are associated with the inflammation for a longer duration. Metabolic diseases, nutritional diseases, and recently, it has been found that the dogs associated with a tachycardia for a longer period, whatever irrespective of etiology, may also lead to cardiac myopathy. Then, dilated cardiomyopathy, some histological studies were conducted. The reason was why the dilated cardiomyopathy is more fatal in some breeds and why not in other breeds. So, for that, they carried. Hello?
Carry on, sir.
So they conducted the histopathological studies. So the two type of the changes were observed in the histopathology. But one was the attenuated baby fiber in myocardium. And this was not restricted to any breed. In all cases, in all breeds, dilated cardiomyopathy, such type of histopathological changes were seen. But second type of changes, this is fibrofatty infiltration, they were restricted to certain breeds. The breeds in which these type of changes were restricted, these were more predisposed to fatality. So their disease was more severe and the result was unpredictable. So sudden deaths in these breeds were more common where there is a fibrofatty infiltration. And this is restricted to the breeds like Doberman, Estrella Mountain Dog, Great Dane, Boxer, German Shepherd, and some other. Now, that's why all breeds have been classified into two. One is highest prevalence and more susceptible, like Doberman, Boxer, Great Dane, Newfoundland, Irish Wolfhounds, English Cocker Spaniel. And less prevalence is German Shepherd, St. Bernard, Labrador, Golden Retriever, Napoleon Mastiff, Rottweiler, Dalmatian, Puli, Greyhound, and mixed breeds. So these are the, on that basis of infiltration, fatty tissue infiltration or fiber nature, they have been breeds have been divided into two. One is more susceptible, is slightly less susceptible. Now, how the pathogenesis occurs in dilated cardiomyopathy? The end result of all heart diseases is a heart failure. A doctor may manage only the heart failure. So how this heart failure end result takes place? So in dilated cardiomyopathy, the two things happen simultaneously. One is neurohumoral disturbances, and other is immune-mediated change. The immune-mediated changes causes persistence of inflammation. In immune-mediated changes have been reflected in the form of increased ESR, then increased number of neutrophils in these cases, increased C-reactive protein, and pro-inflammatory cytokines have increased. So on this basis, they postulated that there is a immune-mediated inflammation which continuously goes on, and that is responsible for fatalities despite our best effort to manage the case clinically. Then second pathway was neurohumoral disturbances. Neurohumoral disturbances were detected in the sympathoadrenal system and renin-angiotensin-aldosterone system, RAS. So they were responsible for causing the blood pressure changes and other things. So these two things, immune-mediated and neurohumoral, they contribute towards the heart failure. And then heart failure is again of a two type. One is a forward failure, where is a systolic dysfunction, where the cardiac muscle is not able to pump the blood to the organ. And other is a congestive heart failure. This is a backward failure, where there is a distension of the vessel. Whole blood is not emptied in the heart. So then congestive heart failure is again of two types, right heart and left heart. Now, what are the major causes which causes the heart failure in DCM? This is in another angle. How, besides these two functions, what are the things which are happening? In heart failure, there is one is a contribution of apoptosis. Apoptosis, programmed cell death. When cardiomyopathy occurs, the number of apoptosis is increased. So there is a more death of the cells, and it is a program. And in this case, when there is a more death, it leads to progressive loss of cardiomyocytes. Number of cardiomyocytes is decreased. And this causes remodeling of fibrous ventricle tissue. Ventricle myocyte tissues are remodeled to take place of the loss of the cardiomyocytes. And then remodeling or the loss of cardiomyocyte, they lead to systolic dysfunction. And systolic dysfunction leads to heart failure. And other things, the other organs, because there is systolic dysfunction, blood is not going to the many organs. So the other organs, key organs like kidney, liver, spleen, thyroid, brain, they are all affected. They are there is less of blood. They are reduced blood supply, so there is a hypofunctioning of these organs, so they lead to the heart failure. Other things in intestine. In intestine, the blood supply is also reduced because of perfusion is less, and because of that, there is a dysbiosis. The balance of the bacteria, healthy bacteria, is reduced. They all lead to inappetence and further complicate to heart failure. And then electrical disturbances, which may take place or may not take place, there may be different type of arrhythmias, they also lead to heart failure. So it is a very complex failure things which occur in a dilated cardiomyopathy, which are responsible for the heart failure. Now, the immunological changes, what type of immunological changes occurs? The most important is a formation of autoantibodies. These autoantibodies against beta adrenergic receptors and mitochondria and myosin. of the heavy chain. Again, the antibodies are formed and they are possibly the responsible that they are not allowing the case to completely cure. So despite our best effort, we only increase the life period of the patient, but there is no complete cure because the autoantibodies are continuously produced and they destroy the cell. And other is a hyperproteinemia, and other is neutrophilic leukocytosis, then lymphocytopenia is also there. And there is an increased production of cytokines, interleukin-1 alpha, interleukin-6, interleukin-8, and tumor necrotic factor. And as a result of formation of autoantibodies and reaction with that, the complexes are formed. And these complexes are responsible for vascular occlusion. So thrombosis, embolies, this is another possibility which is the responsible for sudden death in dilated cardiomyopathy. Now, clinical signs, how a clinician can recognize that there could be chances of heart failure or dilated cardiomyopathy. One important sign is coughing. This coughing is due to the lung congestion in the perihilar region of caudal side of the lung, where there is a more accumulation of the fluid. Because of that, coughing continues. And this accentuates the dyspnea or polypnea, and orthopnea is also seen because the dog is not preferring to lie down. When it lie down during night, during sleep, it accentuates the dyspnea. So dogs remain standing. Then anorexia. Anorexia and dysbiosis, they are related. And this is because of less blood supply, and cachexia, hyperproteinemia, they are all the cause of anorexia. And the anorexia is the cause of cardiac cachexia. And jugular distension, this is a right heart failure sign when backward failure is more. Then syncope, suddenly cases may show they are falling. They are not able to, they are showing coma, they are showing faintness. So such type of syncope when is there, we should suspect that there could be heart problem. Then effusion. Effusions could be in the peripheral organs, in the abdomen, in the lungs, pleura, peritoneum and lymph. They are anywhere this can be. So and exercise intolerance. Though exercise intolerance can be seen in many diseases because it is a sign of the forward failure, because blood is not going to the all organs. So there is a hypoxia and other nutrients are not supplied. So animals are not able to take exercise. So these are the signs which can arouse the suspicion of heart problem or myopathy. Now, which sign is related to which type of failure? We take a forward failure. The forward failure signs are, they are weakness, sleepiness, reduced appetite, reduced activity, exercise intolerance, and cold extremities, pale mucous membrane, and fainting and syncope. They are all related with the forward failure due to systolic dysfunction. Now coming to diastolic dysfunction, this can be classified again into two, left and right side heart. In when left side systolic diastolic dysfunction is there, then shows coughing, open mouth breathing, orthopnea, restlessness during night. This is open mouth breathing. This is ascites. Here jugular distension. You can see here mucous membrane is congested. This congested will be seen only when there is a backward failure. And pale mucous membrane will be seen when there is a more forward failure. And limb edema will also be seen in backward failure, right side. Now, distinction. Why these certain breeds, they differ as a result of, in the outcome of the dilated cardiomyopathy. Why some survive more, why they do not survive more. In some diseases, some breeds, the dilated cardiomyopathy occurs in a juvenile stage. This is contrary to the common belief that cardiomyopathy occurs in a older group and in a larger breed. There are some breeds, small breeds, where dilated cardiomyopathy occurs, like Cocker spaniel. So there is a why the breed specification is there, why breed predisposition is there, because there depends on their genetics. There are certain factors, certain genes which are situated at a different loci, chromosome. They are responsible for making the cases worse, and they can increase the severity of cardiomyopathy. In Doberman, this cardiomyopathy is generally considered as an autosomal dominant trait disease. The locus is on chromosome number 5, which contains a gene that is a DCM-associated single nucleotide polymorphism gene. It's called C allele, SNP C allele. It is situated on chromosome number 5. A locus is there. Because of that, this breed is highly susceptible and shows more fatality. Other is mitochondrial dysfunction. Mitochondrial dysfunction results because of PDK4 mutation and its expression. This has been suggested because of PDK4, the mitochondrial dysfunction takes place and the fatality is increased. And in Europe, the Doberman cardiomyopathy incidence is about 10% in Doberman, and age is 3 to 4 years. And though in both sexes the disease occurs, but male has been slightly more predisposed. And in this Doberman, what happens? The echocardiographic changes in the sex difference. When you take males, you find echocardiographic changes early, while in females, the ventricular arrhythmia is early, and the disturbances may not be detected by echo. So yesterday or before yesterday, we were discussing the role of ECG. We do not know when one technique will help us. So all techniques in all situations has to be applied so that we can combine the result of all and interpret it in a better way. So if it is a female Doberman, here the ECG is the earliest detected by ventricular arrhythmia. If it is a male, then echo will help us in detection. Then here there is a change in morphology of the ventricle dilation, and then electrical disturbances or arrhythmias are of both. This may be atrial and ventricular arrhythmia, but ventricular arrhythmias are more severe and they are responsible for the death in Doberman cardiomyopathy. Now we come to Boxer. Generally, these two types of the cardiomyopathy has been well described in all the texts, but the rest they are not had been well described. This cardiomyopathy of the Boxer is on the adult onset, and it is simulating to arrhythmogenic right ventricular cardiomyopathy, which occurs in human beings, where this is a right ventricle origin. So, in most of the cases, cardiomyopathy is of a left ventricular origin, but it is only the Boxer, which is where it is arising from a right ventricle. And it is there is a familial predisposition, it is a genetical inheritance, and it is inherited through autosomal dominant trait, and age-related penetrance is also there. The age-related penetrance means when it is autosomal dominant, why some offspring shows the disease while others are not. So it is because of age-related penetrance and difference in that way. So this disease occurs in three phases. In preclinical phases, there is no sign, but arrhythmia is there. By ECG, you can detect arrhythmia, but it is asymptomatic. This is a preclinical stage. When overt phase comes, or clinical phase comes, there is an episodic syncope, or exercise syncope, or syncope induced by exercise or excitement. So any Boxer which is showing a syncope or exercise-related syncope should be examined for cardiomyopathy initially. Then comes myocardial dysfunction type, last third stage. Here, congestive heart failure will be seen, which is associated with arrhythmia. Then in these cases, what pathologically, it is a fibrofatty infiltration of the right ventricle. So breed specificity, this is the second type of the histology, which is important and making it more serious. The myocyte atrophy takes place because of patchy necrosis and fibrofatty infiltration. And another important aspect which has been discovered in this Boxer myopathy is cardiac ranodine receptor protein and its messenger RNA expression, which is reduced. Because of that reduction in RYIF2 and messenger RNA expression, the disease is more severe in certain in boxers. And then ventricular arrhythmias of right ventricular origin and left bundle branch block. Right ventricular origin BPCs will be there, and left bundle branch block, they are both associated, and second degree heart block. So there is a complexity in ECG in Boxer cardiomyopathy. Then comes the great dent cardiomyopathy. It is prevalence is highly variable, around 4% to 35%. And disease occurs when the disease takes place in great dent. Survivability is very low. So survival time is very short. And disease is also, this is a recessive trait, where there others were a dominant trait. It is a recessive trait linked with a X chromosome. And in congestive phase, atrial fibrillation was considered more common. This was earlier concept. When the great dent cardiomyopathy occurs, they were thought that it is due to the more atrial fibrillation. That is more common. But latest, nowadays studies has revealed that it is not so much common atrial, but ventricular arrhythmias are more common and they are responsible for the death. Then other is Cocker Spaniel. Cocker Spaniel, though it is a small breed, and it is thought that valvular deficiencies, insufficiencies should occur, but this is only the small breed where dilated cardiomyopathy occurs. And here, the etiology is not certain. It is considered whether it is a hereditary or it may be secondary due to the deficiency of taurine and carnitine. Why? Because the supplementation of taurine and carnitine has improved the quality of the life and functioning and reduced the incidences of cardiomyopathy in Cocker Spaniel. So it is still not clear whether it is a hereditary or secondary. Now, another type of cardiomyopathy which is seen in an infant stage. And this is the Portuguese water dog. In this Portuguese water dog, the cardiomyopathy occurs in the childhood, in the age of 2 to 32 weeks, only 8 months of up to 8 months of age. And it is associated with the locus situated on chromosome number 8 because of that. And it is an autosomal recessive trait transmitted disease. And it is also correlated with a taurine deficiency. And whatever changes in echocardiogram takes place in pups, they are reversible with the taurine supplementation. So this is not very serious. If we supply the taurine, add taurine, then this cardiomyopathy can be very well managed in Portuguese water dog. Then other breed is the Irish Bull found, where the cardiomyopathy is more prevalent. Here the males are more predisposed, and this onset is seen in 3 to 7 years of old dogs, and its association is between AF. Here the atrial fibrillation or flutter or atrial tachycardia, it is a more predominant sign, and any Irish Bull found which shows AF in the ECG should be considered having a cardiomyopathy. Whether any evidence is out there, there is very high correlation between AF and cardiomyopathy in Irish Bull found. So it is closely associated, and it is also inherited, oligogenic inheritance is there. Then in other breed, Newfoundland, prevalence of cardiomyopathy is also 10%, and this is also a old age. During the dogs of 8 years, this is a median age when the disease occurs, and progression of the disease is very slow in this breed. So life survivability is long. So Newfoundland affected with cardiomyopathy could survive or can survive longer, and here there is a reduction in contractibility, and there is an enlargement of the chambers which leads to atrial fibrillation. So here, instead of ventricle, it is the atrium which is enlarged. And because of atrial enlargement, atrial fibrillation and other things takes place, which leads to congestive heart failure. Then echo studies suggest there is a ventricular, left ventricular enlargement is there, and it is autosomal dominant mode of inheritance, and cardiac changes may be secondary to taurine deficiency in this breed. Taurine supplementation improves the survivability and increases the cure rate in this. Now coming to diagnostic approach in how to diagnose the cardiomyopathy. There's, we have discussed last 2 days, the similar is the things are here with clinical symptoms. There is a clinical examination, we can auscultate, find the pulse and jugular examination, x-rays, electrocardiogram, echocardiogram and biomarker. Particularly here, cardiac troponin I and NT-proBNP, they will help us. Now see this radiograph, we should not give overemphasis to any technique. See the both cases you are seeing, the heart shape is not proper, congestion is there, here congestion is there. All congestion and all changes in heart is not associated with a cardiomyopathy. So we have to differentiate the changes in the lungs and the heart in the radiograph, whether they are associated with a lung disease, parenchymal disease, alveolar disease, or of a heart problem. Then VHS, we have discussed, we can find out and we can tentatively say the enlargement pattern. Now see, other is, we are not able to find out the VHS, we can go for intercostal space. How much intercostal space heart is occupied? Generally, 3 to 3.5 intercostal space is occupied by the heart in a cranio to caudal direction. But when it is increased to 4-5 costal space, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, sometimes ticks, then we can say it can be a cardiomyopathy. So VHS versus intercostal, this can also be applied. Then other important thing is there. When heart enlargement is there, there should occur an associated change, that is elevation of main bronchus. Here, this is the trachea. If the heart is not enlarged, this will come like this. But when the heart is enlarged, left ventricle, left auricle is enlarged, it pushes the heart towards up dorsal side. So there is a reduced angle between trachea and the heart, and the trachea main bronchi, they become elevated. So this is an important sign. If this is also detected, we should conduct other tests to find out whether heart changes are there or not. Now, if this is the indication, left heart enlargement, as we have discussed the day before, that the any bulge at 2 to 3 o'clock position, this is the bulge and this is a left atrial bulge. So here the changes are due to the left atrium. Why this is important here? Because in certain breeds we have seen that it is only atrium which shows dilatation. So we can detect if in these breeds if the atrium is there, so there may be cardiomyopathy. Then other lung odema pattern I want to show. Here also you are seeing there are changes in the lung parenchyma. This is a interstitial. Here it is a alveolar changes and dorsal hilar region, dorsal caudal hilar region. Here you seeing the odema. This is an alveolar. Alveolar edema, and this is of a cardiac odema. Here, this type of odema is of a lung disease odema. Then, in nutshell, X-ray proved the existence of pulmonary odema. But because of what region it is, we have to decide. So we have not to overinterpret the odema. Now comes the electrocardiography. And electrocardiography, though it is sensitive for arrhythmia, detecting of arrhythmia, but it is insensitive for detecting cardiomyopathy. So, but in dog, to some extent, when the chamber enlargement is confirmed, so it is the very late stage where the chamber enlargement has taken place. So at that later stage, ECG may tell. But in early stage or middle stage, ECG may not tell. And second thing, ECG is poor interpreter of telling you whether it is to be treated or not for heart. And other things is when to consider it, okay, it is a pathological, when arrhythmias are there, or septal, pericardial effusions are there, or alternance of the wave is there, R wave alternance, T wave alternance is there. Then in such cases, we have to suspect for myocardiopathy. Then chamber enlargement pattern. If it is seen, it is definite. Then syncope or exercise intolerance cases of unknown origin should be subjected to detailed electrocardiographic, echocardiographic, and other investigations. Now, what type of electrocardiographic changes can take place in cardiomyopathy itself? Though they are not specific, but they occur. When the other tests, they confirm the changes of myocardium, then you can correlate the electrocardiographic change. One is LVC, low voltage complex. Generally, low voltage complex is ascribed due to the pericardial effusion. But when there is loss of cardiomyocyte because of more apoptosis, then low voltage complex may occur in cardiomyopathy also. So LVC does not indicate only one thing, but both. Then other is atrial arrhythmia. Atrial arrhythmias are of three major nature: atrial premature complexes, silent atrium, and atrial flutter or atrial fibrillation. Then sinus tachycardia. When the heart rate is increased, but rhythm is not increased. So previously we thought that it is a innocuous, but the persistence of tracheal tachycardia, sinus tachycardia, may also lead to cardiomyopathy. Then AV block. When AV blocks is there, second degree and third degree, this creates a suspension of cardiomyopathy. Then ventricular arrhythmia. Ventricular arrhythmias are always serious or mostly associated with cardiomyopathy. Ventricular tachycardia, ventricular premature complexes. Then we have to decide complexes, whether they are originating in a left ventricle or in a right ventricle. Because in a boxer, this is of a right ventricular origin, these changes. So we have to decide. Then left bundle branch block, because it's a main left bundle branch is a very broad rather than a right bundle branch. So blocks in left bundle branch are very significant and they are very important. Then is a ST segment change. ST segment changes, there are three types of ST segment changes. One is the elevation by 0.2 millivolt, 2.2 or more. And depression, if it is 0.15 millivolt and more, this is pathology. And other is slurring. Slurring is there, elevation or depression, anything may occur. Then other is a wide P. It means left atrium is enlarged. This changes. Then tall R, wide QRS, they are indicative of left ventricular enlargement. So if these changes are there, definitely there is cardiomyopathy. If these changes are not there, you can't say that there is no cardiomyopathy. So we have to be very careful. Now, Dr. Sekhar, this is to clarify yesterday's question, okay, how the ST probing will lead. Here, this is a normal QRS complex. When this is a ST complex, this is elevated here. This is not on this line. So this is an elevation. Here, the ST segment should be here, but ST segment had come down. So this is a depression. See this figure. This R complex and directly converting into T wave. So there is no ST segment. So this is a slurring or co-wave. So here, in a single case, and here is a 1, 2, 3. This is also showing the enlarged R wave, more than 2.5. So, and ST coving is there. So there is likelihood of left ventricular enlargement. So this is the difference of the.
Can we call ST elevation as a J wave here?
No. ST is segment. This is a segment. No spike. Spike is not there. Here, like this S wave, this will be here after S, T comes. Here, this is a ST segment. Here, this is a R wave, and T wave starts. So between T wave, and then R wave, if line is there, if segment is there, if point is there, then it is a ST. Now, why there is a role of echocardiogram? Echocardiogram is definitely will differentiate between hypertrophic and dilated cardiomyopathy or valvular inefficiency or pericardial effusion. This is a echocardiogram of a normal dog showing all the chambers and all the walls. And here you find that this chamber is enlarged. This is the place where this is left atrium enlargement. So this is a enlargement of left atrium in 2D mode, and this is a motion mode, M mode. And here you see dilated cardiomyopathy. Why it is dilated? Here, this is a left atrium, and this is a left ventricle, right ventricle, and right atrium. Here, the left ventricle is enlarged. And here, the left atrium is enlarged. So, these we can decide which chamber is enlarged. And when it becomes the hypertrophic, you have seen the ventricle. This is left atrium, this PA, pulmonary artery. Here, the space available in ventricle is this much, and rest is the wall thickness. So, space available for filling of the blood is reduced, while the wall thickness is increased. So, wall thickness increase from 0.3 mm or 3 mm is always considered pathological. Then, other biomarkers. The importance of biomarkers is because of the secondary cardiomyopathy, where the changes may not occur in the wall or they may not be detected by echo or ECG. So these changes can be detected by biomarkers like cardiac troponin or NT-proBNP. We have discussed regarding them in the earlier lecture. Now, this is it for diagnostic protocol. Now we come how to deal with cardiomyopathy. We have few minutes now, Dr. Sekhar. We have few minutes.
Yes, sir.
So we can quickly discuss the treatment protocol for dilated cardiomyopathy. These are the general aspects where we require a cage rest because we have to reduce the load, post load, after load. Then stress also against to decrease the loads. Then anxiety. In all kinds of heart diseases, their dog is very anxious. So we have to reduce anxiety. We can use digipalm, IV once a day, or we can use the tablet. And oxygenation we have to increase because oxygenation of the blood is reduced. So by oximeter, we can measure the saturation of the oxygen. If it is less, then we can subject the case to the oxygen therapy. In the heart cases, it is 50% oxygen is to be used. And airway patency is to be seen. We have to see whether there is a secretion in trachea or bronchi. If that has to be removed by suction or intubation. And when more pleural effusion is there, we can go for thoracocentesis. Then coming step by step, if oedema has taken place in pulmonary, then we can go for furosemide. Here the dose rate is higher, 2 to 5 mg per kg. It can be IV or IA, both can be IV. Then second thing is when we have to reduce the contraction of the bronchi. So we have to dilate bronchi. So for that, aminophylline 6 to 10 mg per kg, we can use IV or IM or even oral. And theophylline, dose is more than aminophylline, and it can be given as a 20 mg per kg PO, and sustained release theophylline can also be used, that it can be given once. But when normal theophylline is used, we have to give it twice. Then we have to redistribute the body of the blood. Then by applying nitroglycerin on skin area for 3 times a day, by 0.5 to 1 inch square, we can reduce the redistribute the blood. We can use sodium nitroprusside. This is given as a constant rate of infusion. And then after load reduction, by giving enalapril, that can be given at the rate of 0.25 mg per kg BID, and hydralazine, which is 0.5 to 1 mg per kg body weight POBID. By that, we can reduce the afterload. Then contractibility of heart is to be increased because it's a systolic dysfunction in dilated cardiomyopathy. We can use digoxin 0.006 mg per kg as an initial dose rate. And after that, it can be reduced to 0.002 or 0.004. Then dopamine can be used. When the blood pressure is low, but then arterial dilation is there, then we can use dopamine at the rate of 1 to 10 microgram per kg per minute as a CRI. Emrinone can be used into 1 to 3 mg per kg IV, and pimobendin can be used at the dose rate of 0.25 mg per kg POBID for long term. Mind you, pimobendin is only to be used when there is a sign of congestive heart failure. If there is no sign of congestive heart failure, pimobendin has not to be given. Then antiarrhythmic therapy, as for the nature of arrhythmias, if it is a supraventricular arrhythmia, ventricular arrhythmia, then because nature or lidocaine or sotalol. Then other therapies like carnitine, taurine, omega-3 and omega-6 as per their deficiency. And then with it required a constant monitoring. All cases of the cardiomyopathy, they are to be weekly, at least weekly monitored. In the initial stage, daily for 3 to 4 days till the case is stabilized. Now coming to the protocol of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. In hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, positive inotropic drugs are contraindicated because we do not want to increase the contractility of the ventricular muscle, heart muscle. So never use digoxin or pimobendin or any kind of the drug which increases the contractibility of the heart. And then this can be treated with a beta adrenergic drug like propranolol, atenolol, or metoprolol, or calcium channel blockers. Verapamil can be given at the rate of 3 mg per kg TID orally, or diltiazem can be given with diuretic. So, if we are not able to decide or diagnose perfectly, then we can start with the calcium channel blockers or beta adrenergic treatment and with a diuretic. As soon as we improve our diagnosis, we can add the drug. So this is in a nutshell how the cardiomyopathy is being looked nowadays and how we can manage it. So I think this is just a bird eye view about the cardiomyopathy, and questions will be welcome. And it will be great pleasure if I can clarify you.
Vivek, you can continue the question. I'm just contacting all the honorables. Vivek.
Sir, there is no question in question. But sir, I have a question, doubt, SMS. If there is the dog is having cardiomyopathy, suppose it is dilated cardiomyopathy, and along with that, if there is renal failure, then while fluid therapy, we should take any special precaution in such cases?
Yes, yes. We should use in this the half strength DNS. Half strength DNS and dextrose. Dextrose is also half strength. Matlab 0.45% sodium chloride and 2.5% dextrose.
No, I am asking about the volume, sir. What to,
volume will depend on the STT.
Okay.
Or capillary refill time.
Okay.
Or it can go as a constant rate infusion with 20 to 30 drops per minute. Slowly. Okay. As it can be disposed of.
Sir, another question is there. Suppose there is, as we were talking about a cardiac insult, that cardiac biomarkers level is increased. But suppose we are not getting any abnormality in ECG or echocardiography or in X-ray, then what should be our diagnosis and line of treatment?
Yes. In such cases, we should give the drugs which redistribute the volume. You can increase diuretics and propranolol you can use in such cases. And then you can use vitamin E, taurine, or cardiac. But in such case, Pimobend is not to be used.
Thank you, sir.
Is there any question?
Sir, Vivek, I have one question in chat box, please.
Sir, go ahead. Sir, there is a question from Dr. Ramesh Tiwari, sir. How we manage pericardial effusion in dog after cardiosynthesis?
The fate of the pericardial effusion is great. By pericardiosynthesis. And if it is a idiopathic nature, the pericardiosynthesis have to be done every 15 days. Once you do pericardiosynthesis, again the fluid will come at a more speed. So in that case, they remove the pericardial layer. Internal pericardial layer they remove. So there is surgical intervention for that.
Sir, I have one question. Sometimes when you go for dopamine constant rate infusion, it immediately increases the heart rate. So, and sometimes we lose case once in two times we have lost the case.
Right. Dopamine is to be used when the temperature is reduced. When temperature is reduced, arterial blood pressure is reduced. Once the arterial blood pressure comes towards normal, dopamine should be stopped. And the problem with dopamine is the calculation of the dose. If you are able to calculate, but you are not able to maintain the constant rate infusion of about, this is about 10 to 20 microgram per kg per minute. Because we are not in the specified catheter, which can decide the drops. So that is the problem with dopamine.
Can it be used for that?
Constant rate infusion pump. Constant rate infusion pump is there. Can be used for this case?
Yes, we can decide a drop from that. That can be used. For in cardiac and renal, it is actually required. And another thing is that we have a poor facility of measuring the blood pressure. So, we have to constantly measure the blood pressure.
Okay, sir. I think our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Director of Research and Dean sir has joined. So, all the students are here. I think I need a feedback for some of the undergraduate students. If any undergraduate students hearing me, can you give me a feedback of this 3 days workshop on this canine cardiology and its management and treatment. Any students, please? Anand? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Please come. What you have learned, any feedback, any response from student side? Just have a quick...
Sir, first of all, thank you to
Dr. Pallav, respected please sir. Stop the screen sharing.
Okay, sir. Sir, sir, screen share.
Stop kar deta.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Anand, yes, go on.
Yes, sir. First of all, I am very thankful to respected sir. It was a very elaborative and very much useful information. Already we have read about cardiac diseases, sir. Pallav sir has taught us. But sir, you have dealt with very vast and surely we will get benefited by your lecture. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Okay. Ajit, anyone can? Ajit?
Sir, yes, sir, बहुत अच्छा रहा सर, बहुत कुछ सीखे और सर कुछ नया नया चीज भी सीखे सर इसमें, और सर का जो ये नोट्स था ना सर वो एकदम क्लियर, बहुत चीज क्लियर कर दिया सर। और सर क्वेश्चन बोला ना सर, हम लोग क्वेश्चन राउंड ना थोड़ा बढ़ा देते हैं ना थोड़ा, जैसे क्वेश्चन राउंड में बहुत कम हो जाता है समय सर, अगर कोई मतलब कि ऐसे सर आए तो थोड़ा क्वेश्चन राउंड ना थोड़ा बढ़ा दीजिए सर, तो थोड़ा ज्यादा अच्छा रहता है। जैसे सर आप भी क्वेश्चन पूछते हैं तो आप जो पूछते हैं उससे भी तो हम लोग सीखते हैं ना, कि सर ऐसा क्वेश्चन पूछे तो तुरंत हम लोग लिख लेते हैं, और फिर हमारे हम में से भी कोई पूछता है तो उससे भी और मेरा भी क्वेश्चन रहता है, तो थोड़ा ज्यादा क्वेश्चन राउंड थोड़ा इंक्रीज हो जाए।
अभी कोई क्वेश्चन है तो पूछ लो,
अभी पूछ सकते हो, अभी पूछ सकते हो।
सर एक क्वेश्चन था, हाउ टू डायग्नोस द डीसीएम ड्यू टू इम्यूनोलॉजिकल चेंजेस?
नहीं, इम्यूनोलॉजिकल चेंजेस इज अ पार्ट ऑफ पैथोजेनेसिस, डीसीएम इज द सेम, वेदर इट इज इम्यूनोलॉजिकल चेंजेस और न्यूरो हार्मोनल चेंजेस और ट्रॉमा और एनीथिंग, बिकॉज एनी इंसल्ट टू द कार्डियक मसल इज ए कार्डियोमायोपैथी, so these changes decide the fate of the treatment. If the autoimmune bodies are continuing, they may not be the they may affect the expectancy of life may not be prolonged. If there is a more release of pro cytokines, then it will affect the life, that's all. But whatever the change is there, cardiomyopathy is the thing.
कंडीशन अकर इन फॉरवर्ड फेलियर नॉट इन बैकवर्ड फेलियर सर व्हाई
व्हेन द एरिथमियाज आर देयर दे आर फिलिंग इज अफेक्टेड because whether it is a quick matlab tachycardia or bradycardia, the heart filling is affected. When heart filling is affected, it will affect the forward because it is a sympathetic changes, so they affect the heart rate, and heart rate change in heart rate affect the cardiac filling, and when cardiac filling is affected, the forward failure generally occurs. Backward failure takes very long time. So generally the changes are either syncope or weakness or exercise induced weakness, like that only in arrhythmias only, if muscle is not involved.
Okay sir. Okay, thank you sir.
Okay, thank you sir, you have elaborated this topic in a very very elaborated manner in a 3-day session. And the first day the basics was taught, and the second day interpretation of ECG, and third day we have learned about the cardiomyopathy. We have also learned the different breeds of dog that are generally prone to this cardiac diseases. So I just as a general, I want to hear a few words, because our honorable vice chancellor sir, dear sir, and dean sir has just joined this, and he is hearing you in this topic. So just a few words from Dr. JP Vosne sir.
Actually, the in nutshell, the cardiac diseases are increasing day by day in the canine population, partly because we have an improved diagnostic technique, and partly the owners are more conversant or more willing to get their dogs investigated. Second important thing in cardiac diseases is there. Previously, we thought that cardiac diseases occur when only there is a heart involvement is there. But nowadays, the concept has changed that cardiac dysfunctions are seen in the diseases as remote as thyroid, as remote as kidney, as remote as trauma, as remote as myopathy, muscular myopathy, as remote as bacterial viral diseases. So the importance of cardiac diseases is increasing because if we are able to detect them earlier, we can manage other diseases. Whether it is a parvo, it is a distemper, it is a babesiosis, it is trypanosomiasis, it is a metabolic disturbances like milk fever, eclampsia, hypomagnesemia. If we are able to detect some changes in the heart, we can take care of them and can improve the survival rate or cure rate of the other diseases. So in that way, the evaluation of the heart, irrespective of the disease, whether history hints it or not, is a very, very important. So as a clinician, we have to go for... I don't say that in each case, conduct ECG or conduct ECHO. No, but other evaluation of the heart should be conducted in each case so that you can decide whether you have to go for ECHO or ECG or cardiac biomarkers or not. But any case which is showing emergency or any seriousness or prolonged diseases should always be thoroughly evaluated for a heart, whether they are because of nervous region or kidney region or liver region or any region. So in a nutshell, though it is a very broad, nowadays cardiology is very vast.
Thank you, sir. And we will take a note of this. Now I request Dean, sir, to have some view on this workshop, 3 days workshop, sir. Dr. J.K. Prasad, sir. Hello.
Mute.
Sir, Dean, sir.
Yeah. Hello. Yeah. Thank you. Am I audible, please?
Yes, sir.
So thank you very much, Dr. Pallav. I'm really grateful to our speaker, Dr. J.P. Bhosne, sir, for his 3 days very much exhaustive deliberation on this cardiac disease diagnosis. And I do believe that all our faculty members and students who have joined this very program, they might have imbibed a lot with the vast experienced lecture of Dr. Bhosne. Because this is the beginning itself, because here if you see the condition of our veterinary clinical complex, routinely we are getting 60 to 20 cases, and out of all those cases, I believe that a good number of cardiac patients might be there. The thing is how to diagnose the things, because our ultimate aim of all these cardiac diseases should be that there should be early diagnosis. Because when we are able to diagnose the cases early, at early stage, certainly we'll be able to manage in a better way. And I'd like to request our Bhosne sir, whenever will this lockdown problem will be over in future, so he must accept our invitation to come here and please have a hands-on training for our faculty members.
Definitely, sir. It will be great pleasure to interact with the faculty. Whenever you have time, you can call us. I will take a leave from this place and will come.
Yeah, certainly, sir. Because this will be our fortunate part, because we'll have our faculty member will get enriched by your vast experience. So here I like to also appreciate Dr. Pallav for arranging such a nice educative webinar by Dr. Bhosne, sir. So thank you very much, sir.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you.
So thank you, sir, Dean, sir. Now it's time now to hear from our Honorable Vice Chancellor. So I would like to request, sir, to have a few words of blessings for us.
थैंक यू डॉक्टर पल्लव, डॉक्टर वार्ष्णेय, डॉक्टर रविंदर, डॉक्टर जेके प्रसाद, ऑल फैकल्टी मेंबर्स एंड डियर स्टूडेंट्स. दिस 3-day वर्कशॉप हैज कम टू ए कंक्लूजन एंड आई प्रोफ्यूजली थैंक डॉक्टर वार्ष्णेय फॉर एक्सेप्टिंग आवर रिक्वेस्ट.
थैंक यू सर.
कंडक्ट दिस वर्कशॉप and spare 3 very valuable days for single-handedly for this activity. Dr. Vasne, as all of you know, and he has taught you now, he is one of the leading authorities on canine cardiac problems and having very vast experience. I could see that enthusiasm of students and faculty, and large number of them, I have been told, they watched your lectures on Facebook, more than 450, and also the today's presence was also around 40. It includes our faculty, our PG students, and some of the UG students also. So this awareness on cardiology or cardiac health of animals, that we have to appreciate. As Dr. Vasne was telling, the numbers are going up and the reasons are very well known, that owners are becoming more, you know, conscious about these problems, and they are willing to bring their animals for further investigation and get the treatments. This area, which you know, requires very specialized attention, and it is a central organ for all living, you know, mammals or other animals also, and the kind of issues, they are very, very important to understand and appreciate. Whenever I go to the clinics, I always ask our team to prepare the database of images very in a systematic manner with keywords and in a searchable manner, and use the database of images, maybe X-ray images, maybe ultrasound images, maybe other, you know, any kind of images we are having, the clinical images, mainly X-ray we are having maximum, I believe. So I was looking at your images when you were making your presentations. I joined, you know, in between and briefly spent some time with you. So I saw the lot of emphasis and lot of teaching was done through the images, and the students also appreciated when they saw the images, and you correlated the case history or the symptoms or the diagnosis with the images. So this has been re-emphasized. I will again re-emphasize that store all your images, share your images. You may put them on the website also, so that others can also access those images. Small description may be added to all the images, and a good library should be constructed. So this type of library can be federated also from different colleges and different institutions, so that we have multiple images available for different conditions. So friends, I, on behalf of all of you, I take this opportunity to thank Professor Vasne once again. And as Dr. Prasad was requesting him to come to the campus and have a hands-on, you know, kind of workshop where you can use all the gadgets and all the equipment. And Dr. Vasne has given his acceptance, is confirmation that whenever opportunity arises, he will be in Patna, and he will do the needful. So grateful for your our readiness.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
To help us and help our
youth. Thank you very
much. So, the
thank you very much,
discussion
sir.
Has also been very lively. I could see the questions kind of interaction with the students and your patience. That was great. Wonderful work, Dr. Varsney. And
thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
I also compliment the organizers for taking this initiative, and I will urge upon other faculty members also to look for such opportunities and give their suggestions and carry on this activity. So we are trying to make best use of the social distancing period. And in many ways, I find that this opportunity has opened up our mind also.
Right.
We were, not having this luxury of getting this type of inputs or this type of lectures or this type of workshops without inviting people to Patna. Now, we are fortunate that Dr. Varsney is connected with us. Many other like him also have given their time, and we have been able to get the benefit from experts from India as well as from abroad. So that one thing has gone deeper in our mind, that technology we should harness always. It may be normal period, or it may be a difficult period, but we must make good use of technology. It saves time, it saves money, it is a big enabler. So today we are face to face, and we have seen all the images, all the details which Dr. Varsney presented. So being tech savvy and arranging our own things properly, all the technology, all the connectivity, so I'll look forward to development of new courses also by the faculty for online dissemination. Right. Maybe artificial insemination training, or material for farmers and all that. So we can prepare good videos and also record the lectures and use all the images and photographs or videos available with us to make things more look like real presentation, real life presentation. So wonderful, Dr. Varsney.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Yeah. I am grateful to you. You have given me the
so nice of you
time to interact with you. Right. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.
So thank you, sir, for your visit, sir, for this. Yes, sir. I request the senior faculty of veterinary medicine, Dr. Bipin Kumar, to have a vote of thanks. Dr. Bipin, please.
For giving me the opportunity to propose a vote of thanks. Honorable Vice Chancellor, sir, Dr. Rameswar Singh, sir, Bihar Animal Sciences University. Respected Director of Research, sir, Ravindra Kumar, sir. Respected Dean, sir, Dr. J.K. Prasad. And our most valued invited guest and today's resource person, Dr. J.P. Varsney, sir. It's my pleasure to have been asked to propose a vote of thanks on this occasion. And I, on behalf of organizing committee and my own behalf, I extend a very heartily vote of thanks to Honorable Vice Chancellor, Bihar Animal Sciences University. Sir, your constant and untired endeavor motivate us to do something off the track to bring laurel to the Bihar Animal Sciences University. And your guidance, without your guidance, we cannot organize such kind of webinar to help our faculties and our students to gain something through online mode from the persons who are seated out far away from the DVC campus or from our university. So once again, I thank you, sir, for giving us opportunity to organize such a nice webinar. And now I thank Dr. J.P. Varsney, sir, for his efforts towards diagnosis and management of canine cardiac disorders in very comprehensive manner. And it has been very useful for our students, those who are interested to pursue their PG program in cardiac disease. And even many of the faculty members, even I myself, got very much benefited from this lecture, because we are facing a lot of problem in dealing with the cardiac disorder cases which are frequently coming to us. But due to lack of knowledge in this particular field, we are not able to diagnose properly, and so many cases we are losing. So after this webinar and this training, we will be able to diagnose some cases and we could save the life of our dogs which are coming to clinic for help. So this will be very helpful for us, sir. And considering the vast nature of cardiac disorder, through one seminar, through one webinar, we cannot do everything, right. But we'll try our best to do something for the society, sir. Thank you, sir. I must mention our deep sense of appreciation to our respected director research, sir, Ravindra Kumar, sir, who has constantly encouraging us to organize such kind of webinar to benefit us as well as to our student. So thank you again, sir, to giving me opportunity to organize such kind of webinar. Now I like to express our sense of gratitude to Dean Dr. J.K. Prasad for constantly encouraging us or motivating us to organize online training through various mode, either on Zoom, Microsoft Teams, and other so many portal are available for us to organize the things. And we are also encouraging our students to remain in contact with Sir Advice, and so many students has got benefited from the so many webinar which is being organized by different pharmaceutical companies like Zydus, Intas, and so many other companies has organizes many times a webinar on different relevant topics, which is very, very useful for the clinical persons or the student who are pursuing PG program in the clinical subjects. And I'm also very grateful to PRO Satya Kumar for preparing a nice booklet, or you can say that material to spread the message of organization of webinar. So it also needs thanks. And I'm very grateful to the faculty members and all the participants who participated in this webinar and remain in touch constantly and have a very live discussion with our expert and ask many pertinent questions regarding the cases which are coming to the clinic and how it should be diagnosed and how it should be treated. They must have got some information from this seminar, and I expect the services at clinical complex will be improved a lot in concerning the cardiac disorders. And last, again, I want to say that we all are grateful to you, sir, Dr. J.P. Varsney, sir. We thank you for being with us. It has been great pleasure for us. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Thank you, sir. With the permission of Honorable Vice Chancellor, I am concluding this session. Thank you, sir.
Dr. Varsney, Patna, aye hai college mein pehle?
Nahi, sir. I have not come to Patna.
Okay, okay. Chaliye,
sir. COVID start hone ke pehle, sir, inko